day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. What a glorious day to be in God's house with God's people. Welcome to worship at First Baptist Church. We are so glad that you are here with us.
If you are a guest with us this day, thank you for being here. And we hope that in our worship, you will experience God's presence for your life. And for those of you worshiping at home, thank you so much for joining with us as we worship together. So now let us turn our hearts and our minds to the worship of our God as we listen to our prelude.
Good morning. I invite you now to open your worship guide as we read responsively our call to worship. Join me now. From water to wilderness, God's covenant continues. God's kingdom comes near. On stone and in hearts, God's covenant continues. God's kingdom comes near. from the ancestor of the nations to the Son lifted up. God's covenant continues. God's kingdom comes near. We follow Jesus on the Lenten path. For where he is, we would be also. Pray with me now. Our Lord and God, as we come on this day that you have created for us, you have given each of us an opportunity to be in this place. And it is our desire as brothers and sisters in Christ that you be lifted up this day and also all the days of our lives. And Lord, as we come this day, we just pray that in all things that we do, through prayer, through music, through your inspired word, Lord, we just pray that you would be pleased. Lord, now as we come in this place, be with us now. For it's in the name of Christ we do pray. Amen. I invite you now to stand as we sing hymn 285, God of Grace and God of Glory. We'll sing all four verses. Please stand. Be seated.
The scripture reading this morning comes from Psalm 107, and I'm going to read two different parts of it. The first part tells us to give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he has redeemed from trouble and gathered in all the lands, from the east, from the west, from the north, and from the south. And now, 17 to 22, and this could be entitled, The Lord Delivers Us from Trouble. gates of death. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them from their distress. He sent forth his word, and he healed them, and he delivered them from destruction. Let them thank the Lord for his steadfast love, for his wonderful works to the sons of man. Let them offer thanksgiving and tell of his deeds in songs of joy. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
I'd like to welcome these folks who are worshiping with us from home, Diane and Mike Goodwin, Donna Smedley, Sandy Kraft, and Ron Kraft, Deanna, y'all are right there. Okay, well, someone has stolen your Facebook account and is logged in. Okay, so let's see, Dee Dee Huer, Bill and Betty Long, Deanna Heishman, Brian, Donya, Avery, and Christian Feinerfrock, Joey Biggs, Marja Kitts, Janice Nicey, and Sharon and Troy Lane. So welcome. Thank you so much for worshiping with us from home. So boys and girls who are at home, I have a question for you. Have you ever gone on a trip? Maybe you traveled by car, or maybe an airplane, or maybe a boat. Have you ever played games while you were traveling to pass the time? I know my brother and I, we played lots of games in the car. We played find the license plate from every state. Maybe some of you played that game. You know, you write them all down. We also played I Spy. You know, I spy something blue or green. We also played I'm going on a picnic. You ever played that one? I'm going on a picnic, and I'm going to take, and then you say something that starts with an A, apple. And then the next person says, I'm going on a picnic, and I'm going to take an apple and also a banana. And so you go through the whole alphabet. And by the end, whoever's last has to remember all 26 items. So we played that in the car. We loved to play games in the car because, especially back when we were growing up, there was no screens. We didn't have phones. We didn't have iPads. And so we had to come up with creative things to do. Well, the song that Miss Mary Ann just read a moment ago was something that the Israelites sang while they were on a journey. They sang that song to pass the time as they were walking to their destination. And back in those days, they didn't have. They had to either ride an animal or walk everywhere they went. So you can imagine they went on some long journey.
and those who are distant neighbors. Help us to speak the words of blessing and kindness rather than words that belittle or distort. Turn us away from violence, falsehood, and selfishness. Forgive us for thinking everything depends on our efforts and power. For you are the God who made us, led us out of slavery, and has brought us into the community of faith. Help us depend on you alone and to rest in your peace. In Christ's name we pray.
God did not send the Son into the world to condemn it, but in order that the world might be saved through him. In the name of Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Let us continue as we lift up our voices in praise as we sing, Bless the Lord, hymn 367. We'll sing it two times through.
Through the ages, your presence in our lives is undeniable. Creation has spoken of your care and benevolent love, and you sent your Son into our midst so that there could be no denying your concern for our well-being. You are our God who restores all that your people destroy, and you mend brokenness and bring wholeness in the midst of fractured relationships. You make wars to cease and establish peace among all nations. We hear your word for our time and give thanks for your unending pursuit of loving us. And so we pause this morning to pray for those who are on our hearts and in our minds by now speaking aloud their names. Lord, hear our prayers. 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 God, we pray for those whose relationships are in disarray. Keep us from premature or harmful judgments that only enhance the pain. Help us to be your presence in the lives of those who are lonely. You have taught us how to love one another, and you have shown us how interdependent all creation ought to be. Keep us mindful of the mutual support we can offer one another, and make us willing to bear another's burdens as though it was our own. Help us to love one another as you love us. For it's in the name of Christ we pray. Amen.
Well, I'm going to start off something pretty soon. So, already, are you awake? Deep down in Louisiana, close to New Orleans, way back in the woods, and one way up.
Oh, I'm sorry, Joyce, I told you that's a proper song. I'll try something different.
Okay.
Thank you, Jerry. I was a little worried there at the beginning. That's right, I did. I was thinking people might pull out their lighters, you know, cell phones. So thank you so much for helping us worship this morning, Jerry. So we continue in our series of covenants by reading from the New Testament today. I'm going to be reading Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. You were dead through the trespasses and sins in which you once lived, following the course of this world, following the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work among those who are disobedient. All of us once lived among them in the passions of our flesh. Following the desires of flesh and senses, we were by nature children of wrath like everyone else. But God, who is rich in mercy out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved and raised up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. Will you please pray with me? Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So the name of our sermon this morning is We Are Royal. So did you happen to watch last Sunday night Oprah's TV special where she interviewed Prince Harry and Princess Meghan Markle? Did some of you watch that? Some of you did. Some of you said, no way. Well, years ago, almost 250 years ago, in fact, we Americans fought a war against the British so that we would not have the rule anymore of a king or a queen. Yet we Americans, for some reason, are still fascinated by British royalty. Did you know that over 17.1 million people watched that broadcast on CBS last Sunday, which was the most watched non-sports program since the 2020's Oscar broadcast? So a lot of people watched that interview. From a very young age, American children watch Disney movies about princesses and princes. And then they get to travel to Disney World and meet all of those fantasy royals. And a lot of times children want dolls or toys or clothing where they can pretend to be a prince or a princess. For a country that has been so against royalty, against kings and queens, we sure are enamored by them. When I was growing up in my Baptist church back in Columbia, South Carolina, I went to GA's, Girls in Action, a mission organization, every Wednesday night. And then later, when I became a teenager, I went to ACT Teens, where we memorized scripture, we learned about missionaries around the world, we prayed for them, and we also engaged in mission projects. I worked on my first Habitat for Humanity house as an ACT Teen. And if we completed all of our steps, which were activities that were related toward missions, then we earned different things. And one of those things you earned was a crown. Then you earned a scepter. And then you earned a cape. Now, all of these awards were presented at a coronation service where you would wear a beautiful white gown. And I've seen pictures over there in the historical room of coronation services here held in this sanctuary. Maybe some of you went through that when you were a young girl growing up. So on this fourth Sunday of Lent, we jump from our Old Testament study of covenants to the New Testament. In the past few weeks, we have examined God's one-sided covenant with Noah to never destroy the earth again by water. Then we looked at God's covenant with Abraham and Sarah to make them ancestors of a great nation, and in return, they only had to worship the one true God. And then last week, we examined God's covenant with the people of Israel, given in the form of the Ten Teachings, or the Ten Commandments. These commandments gave the people of Israel guidance for how they were to live their lives, worshiping God and loving and serving their neighbors. All of these covenants were God's attempt to have a relationship with God's beloved people, the very people that God created and desired to be in relationship with. But each time, the people failed. But God did not give up. From the very beginning of our creation, God has relentlessly pursued relationships with each of us. First, God created humans and gave them everything they needed by putting them in the Garden of Eden. But then they messed up and did what God had asked them not to do. Then God tried again when sending Adam and Eve out into the world. But they sinned again by Noah's day. Then the earth was destroyed, and God had to start all over again with Noah's family. Then years later, the people of God, because of the mistakes they made with Joseph and not trusting God during a famine, they ended up becoming slaves in Egypt. So God sent Moses to lead them out of slavery. And then as they were headed to the promised land, they failed to trust that God would care for them, and they ended up wandering around in the wilderness for 40 years. And I could go on and on and on through the stories of the Old Testament. Each time, the people of God forgot that they were God's beloved people. They made mistakes and sinned, and God could have given up on them. But instead, God continued to try different approaches to see if the people would choose to follow. In a way, it's similar to raising children. As parents, you try to figure out what motivates your child to follow the rules and do what needs to be done. For some kids, a stern word, or perhaps a raise in the pitch or the tone of your voice might work. But for other children, rewards are what seems to motivate them and get the things done they need to get done. For instance, if you clean your room, then you can have an hour of screen time. And for other children, the opposite works. If you don't clean your room, you are going to lose your screen time. For Shane and for me, it was really easy to motivate Paige to do what we needed her to do because she didn't want to disappoint us. All we had to do was to tell her what we expected, and for the most part, she obeyed. Now, for Reed, it's a different story. It was much harder to figure out what would motivate him because Reed is a happy-go-lucky kind of kid. You could offer him rewards or you could threaten to take away his favorite toy, and he didn't really seem to care either way. Well, I think that's how it is with God and with us. You see, God tries this, and then we mess up. And then God tries something else, and we messed up again. And then God's going to try that, and we still mess up. And then finally, God brings out the big guns and sends God's own son, Jesus Christ, to show us how to live by his life and by the example of his life. Jesus showed us how to live, how to love, how to care, and how to worship. Jesus becomes this new covenant between God and between us. And every time we gather around this communion table, we remember that new covenant. We say in the words of institution, this is the cup of the new covenant. Jesus, the Son of God, becomes the very embodiment of this new covenant between God and us. This passage from Ephesians is a reminder of the magnitude of God's love and mercy and grace for us, God's people. However, before we can fully appreciate what God has done for us through Jesus Christ, we have to examine the depth of our need. We are in need because we are dead because of sin, because of the ways that we orient ourselves to things that are not of God. We tend to put ourselves first. We tend to ignore those who are in need. We tend to judge others. We tend to not realize the ways that we oppress and hurt others. And oftentimes, we are not even aware of how our actions affect others. For instance, we are probably not aware of how our fruits and vegetables are often picked by people, many times children, who live in conditions that we would not find acceptable for our own children. Or we buy our cell phones that are made with dangerous metals that unprotected children retrieve from old phones. Our participation in our common economic life implicates us in injustice that is opposed to God's desire for all of humanity to live and prosper. Unfortunately, we are all captured by sin and are both willing and often unwilling participants in it. Well, have you seen the 1986 movie, The Mission? Shane and I actually watched it last night. It is based on the work of Jesuit priest in the 18th century who lived in South America. Robert De Niro plays a former soldier named Rodrigo who would ride into the highlands, capture natives, and then sell them into slavery. In a fit of rage over a woman, Rodrigo kills his own brother, which causes him to seek refuge and retribution for his sins at the Jesuit monastery in the city. Disgusted with what he has become, Rodrigo calls for a cell, goes to a cell where he can die all by himself because of his sins. The Jesuits there are missionaries, and they are called to carry God's love to the highlands. So the lead priest works out a deal with Rodrigo. Because he won't accept God's forgiveness, Rodrigo instead will do penance. The penance will be that he will join these Jesuits as they make an arduous climb up a large mountain and waterfall to live with and share the good news of Christ's love with the natives that Rodrigo once enslaved. So he agrees, but only if he is allowed to drag his weapons and his armor, the metal vestiges of his former life, behind him in a massive rope net in order to make that journey up that mountain and up that waterfall even more painful and difficult. So after a long, grueling trek, the priest finally arrived at the jungle village with Rodrigo slowly coming up behind them. He's exhausted, and he thinks in his mind that he will probably be killed by those natives that once he enslaved because they will recognize him. Indeed, this looks to be the case because one of the villagers runs out to the muddy, depleted slave trader, grabs a fistful of his hair, pulls his neck back, and puts a knife to his neck. Taking notice, the chief calls out to the villager and says, and makes him take the knife away. And instead of slicing his neck, he cuts the ropes binding Rodrigo to that huge net of weapons and armor. And that tangle of rope and metal is then shoved off the cliff and down into the river. Disbelieving and free, Rodrigo breaks down sobbing. The villagers and the Jesuit brothers surround him with hugs and tears and laughter, and they lead him into a life of living out his forgiveness and freedom. No matter how hard we try, we will never be free until we trust in the comprehensive and unbreakable promise of God's love for us. A love that pursues us relentlessly, comes to us as one of us, envelops us, and shows us how to fully love and live as God's beloved children. Through Jesus' life, we are shown that to live a life that responds to God's enduring love with enduring love. We are shown that God responds to us, and we can respond to God's commitment to us with perfect obedience. Here's the overwhelming truth. Only God can keep God's covenants. And because of our failure to keep our end of the covenant with us, with God, God pulled out the big guns and sent Jesus to become one of us and make a new covenant with us. Through faith in Christ, we are saved, not by works. And that faith is unbreakable because it begins and it ends, is initiated and answered by the perfect love of God. And through that faith, we are raised up with Jesus and are seated with him in the heavenly places. Through Christ, we are made alive. So friends, do you ever have a bad day? When everything seems to be going wrong, when the water is running the wrong way? On those days that are filled with failure, imagine being seated with Jesus. Imagine being seated with Jesus on days when you feel abandoned or excluded. Imagine sitting with Jesus on the days that you feel like giving up. Imagine sitting with Jesus while facing the end of your earthly life. Through Jesus, we are promised new life. We are made alive. And Christ does not just bring us out of death to life. Christ makes us royalty. Because we are seated with Jesus, we have become royal. We are royalty. Not royalty like Harry and Meghan, what they gave up, or what teens earn at their coronations, but true royalty that basks in the love and grace and mercy of God. True royalty that makes one whole, physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. True royalty where sins are forgiven and life can be lived to the fullest. But that gift of royalty comes with some responsibility. We are not just to relax by the swimming pool, sipping our little drinks with the umbrellas sticking out of the top. Instead, Paul reminds us of the second part of the equation. For we are what he made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared to be our way of life. Yes, we are saved by grace through faith. And no, we don't have to rely upon our good works to be saved. But we are what God has made us, people created in Christ for good works. Instead of being frantic for ways to save ourselves by doing good works are the opportunity for us to live out our lives in the ways that we were created to be. Good works are the expressions of Christ alive in us, ministering to our world. Good works are demonstrations of our present reality and our future. We are God's royal children, exercising God's love in the world. My dear friends, this coming week, when you're going about your life, please remember that you are royalty. You are true royalty because God loves you. So remember to get out your crown and polish it off every morning and wear it proudly because you are God's beloved child. That is my hope for you this week. Amen. Now let's reflect on these things and the ways God is speaking to us as we listen to Sue.
please stand for our doxology? We don't thank you enough for all the blessings that you provide for us. We don't thank you enough for the sunshine that lights our face this morning, the warm temperatures, and the beginning of spring. We also don't share enough of our love that's been shared from you, from your Son. But help us. We are the children of God. We are all sinners. We have confessed that we've been forgiven. Help us. Stand with us. Share a little kindness. Share a smile. Pass on the love that you provided to us. We have received gifts today that they may be used by this church in order to further your word. They may buy a meal for a child that doesn't have one. Help a family that hasn't eaten that week. Share the love, not hate. Share the love that's been provided to us. Amen.
Thank you. Be seated for just a moment, please. Just a few matters of common concern. Our mission offering this month is going to support Habitat for Humanity, so we encourage you to give toward that mission offering to help Habitat build homes and repair homes here in our community. Also, there is a pandemic victory garden that functioned last summer down on Luray Avenue down here. You may have seen it as you go towards the river, but it is going to happen again this year. There's a group of volunteers that are providing fresh fruits and vegetables. I think they provided 2 tons of fruits and vegetables last year in the community for free. So they are going to do that garden again, and it's even going to be bigger, and so they need help. If you are interested in helping, it's basically just one day if you could volunteer a couple of hours, 2 or more hours to help weed or pick vegetables, please let me know. They would like for us, First Baptist, to have a week that we take care of the garden. So if you're willing to help with that, please let Kayla know in the church office. Also, we're starting to take orders for our Easter flowers. Easter is right around the corner, and we want to have our sanctuary decorated with beautiful flowers as we celebrate Christ's resurrection. And we are also beginning to accept nominations for a deacon. Anyone who's interested in serving can nominate themselves, or you can nominate other people that you would think would be good deacons. We will contact them and see if they're willing to serve. And if they are, we'll have a training session so that you know what you're getting yourself into. And then we will have a deacon election coming up soon. Will you please now stand for the benediction? My brothers and sisters in Christ, we have received the immeasurable richness of God's grace. We have been given a seat at the right hand of Jesus and have been made royalty because of God's mercy. So go forth now and share that gift with those you meet. Go in peace. Amen.